Welcome, and thank you for watching this third episode of our Top Trends in State and Local Government video series. These videos are a series of discussions with industry experts that aim to shed light on current trends and technology in the realm of local governments and public policy. I'm Samir Saini, Industry Director for U.S. State and Local Government at Microsoft. Now, today, we're excited to speak with Laura Chace. She's the President and CEO of the Intelligent Transportation Society of America, or ITSA. Now, in that role, she strives to promote policies that advance the development and safe deployment of intelligent transportation technologies throughout the U.S. Laura's work is informed by her extensive experience in strategic planning, operations, communications, and advocacy. She has a proven track record of implementing complex initiatives, including ones that focus on technology's ability to save lives, reduce crashes on the U.S. roadways, reduce congestion, minimize transportation's carbon footprint, and provide seamless mobility and transportation choices for all Americans. Laura is also the founding member of the Mobility XX Initiative, which is aiming to increase the number of women working in the transportation sector by 10% in 10 years. Welcome, Laura. It's good to see you.
Thank you. Great to see you too, Samir. Thanks for having me.
So let's start, Laura, with your work on transportation and technology. Can you talk about how state and local governments are, specifically transportation agencies, are using data and AI to tackle some of the big challenges I just referred to around modernizing transportation infrastructure, reducing congestion, and also advancing their Vision Zero initiatives as well?
So this video series is about trends, and the biggest trend that's hitting our transportation industry right now is the investment in digital infrastructure. You know, if you think about the last 50 years of our transportation system, we're built with concrete and steel, but the next 50 are going to be built with software and code. And this is a digital infrastructure layer that we talk about a lot that really links the physical realm to this digital world. And what it allows us to do, and the reason it's so important, is it allows us to communicate, share, store, analyze, and use the data and information you're talking about in real time to save lives, provide faster emergency response, mitigate impacts of extreme weather, improve resiliency of our infrastructure, reduce emissions, enhance mobility, and even distribute services more equitably to communities. So really, you know, this trend and everything we're talking about today is really, in my view, the future of transportation and how we manage our systems. But to get to some specifics, let me tell you a couple of examples of what's going on. And there's a lot. So these are just a few examples. In Bellevue, Washington, they have used 360-degree high-definition traffic cameras at 40 intersections to improve their data collection and analysis capabilities. They have a really robust Vision Zero plan in Bellevue, and it's all based on data. And so they've selected intersections that have different characteristics and geography in their land use, population density, even road geometry. Mm-hmm. And what they're doing is they're using all this video feed and an AI software to actually identify traffic volumes, road user speeds. And the reason this is so important is that this allows the city to have real-time data on where are people speeding and why. Is it occurring in the same corridors, in the same locations? Where are these near misses occurring? That's something that in transportation we haven't tracked as much as we should have, a lot of transportation professionals believe. And that could really unlock some core safety benefits if we can actually see where are these misses happening and why. And so this allows them to use that information to determine what to do to improve safety. And the answer could be, it could be what I'm going to call an analog answer, right? It could be that they have to redesign an intersection. Sure. But it could be that there's a technology solution that could be applied. And now they have that information to understand what's happening.
Those are some amazing examples. Let's turn to sustainability. So we know the EPA recently reported that 27% of carbon emissions is a result of the transportation network and the transportation system, which is absolutely massive. Now, I know that one of ITS America's core focus areas is reducing the transportation carbon footprint. Can you give some examples around how transportation agencies, governments are using technology to tackle this sort of sustainability challenge and achieve their sustainability goals?
this is really an example where what I'm going to call just really core ITS technologies shine, right? Mm-hmm. So active traffic management technologies, used to dynamically manage traffic using real-time data and traffic signal technologies that allows you to reroute traffic and time your signals to reduce congestion and emissions. That's really important. States across the country use that. Georgia and Minnesota are two that are leading on that. But the reason it's so important is because even though the entire auto industry is going to electrification, and even though you're seeing a push to that, it's going to take a decade, right? Most reports say, until we go to full electric vehicles. And we can get some significant emission reductions just by using traffic management and ITS technologies. And so that's something that's really important for states and localities to be thinking about and ensuring that they're using those technologies to help meet their sustainability goals.
So Laura, what are some of the emerging technologies you're beginning to see transportation agencies begin to adopt to help them with planning, operations, maintenance of the transportation network?
So, I think we're seeing, I'd say, a huge proliferation in AI-based tools. Mm-hmm. AI-based tools and predictive tools for managing systems, and then also digital twins. Digital twins for both planning and operations, I think, have really enabled agencies to use real-time data in their decision-making. And that's been a big change over the past several years. So whether it's being prepared to respond to a major emergency or a disaster, whether it's understanding, what's going to happen to your road network if you have to, close down different roadways or arterials, this is helping agencies not only get the information, but have it be turned into actionable information that they can use in real time and understand it. And I think for a long time, I talked about this at the beginning, governments have spent billions and billions of dollars on concrete, mm-hmm. but not much on optimizing that concrete. And these new tools, right, the AI, predictive analytics, digital twinning, et cetera, they really allow agencies to optimize what we've already built and optimize their physical assets and allow for dynamic management of those assets. So it's really a benefit, not only for the agencies, but for all the residents in the communities that they serve.
Before we wrap up, I want to touch on an issue that you're passionate about. You speak often about the need to include more female and diverse representation in the transportation workforce. Can you talk about how working toward that call can create better outcomes for all of us who use the transportation system?
Yeah, absolutely. You're right. This is very important to me. So if folks listening are not aware, women make up only about 15% of the transportation workforce and even fewer in decision-making roles. And the reason that's important is because we know that women spend more on transportation than men. They pay more for safety. And in fact, in many cases, they pay twice as much for transportation than men. Mm-hmm. Women spend twice as much time taking transportation as men. And that's because we often trip chain. A certain mode may not really be available to us because it may not meet our needs and where we need to go and when we need to get there. 3 in 4 women are street harassed. So women are subject to much more harassment on public transit and in public spaces. And so safety is a big issue. And then finally, women are 17% more likely to die in a car crash. That's because the standards are based on the male body. And so when you factor all that together, and then you think about the fact that, at least half our population is women. And if you look at transit, transit users are more heavily female. You realize that if you're not actually solving for women, then you're not actually creating mobility and transportation to serve everybody's needs. So I often say, when you solve for women, you're solving for families and you're solving for communities. And I think that's really important in transportation because transportation at its core connects us to all the opportunities that we need to live fulfilled lives. It connects us to our jobs, it connects us to education, to healthcare, to critical services. And so we need to make sure that we address the needs of women as well as men and others in the population so that we actually get, that we're building and delivering transportation services that serve everyone.
Absolutely. So thank you, Laura, for sharing your perspectives and insights today. If you're interested in hearing more perspectives on top trends in state and local government, watch the rest of our series with features with other industry experts discussing the latest trends that they're seeing at the intersection of technology and government. So thank you.